great audience. Now I'd like to invite up our moderator and guest for tonight. Let's catch my breath. First up, our moderator. What was the initial starting point of the script?
First of all, thank you. I'm really bad with this. I'm like, you know, Will Ferrell, Targeta Nights. This was my first screening with an audience of Finnish movie, and it was on 35mm, and it was super fucking special. It was super fucking special. I'll say thank you a little bit now, before because first of all, when we're here in this temple of cinema, which is the New Beverly, I've been watching movies here, and screening a movie here is so special, and thank you to the Beverly, to Jules, to Quentin. We'll say more thank yous in the end, so we wouldn't, because there are a lot of people here. By the way, there are people from the production who haven't came to see me that came sneaking in on my tickets. So, back to the screenwriting. Ehud, say hi. Ehud, who co-wrote it with me, is here. I think that for us, it always starts with watching a lot of movies. And we see an idea, and we're like, oh, that's an interesting idea. Let's borrow that. But we need to change it enough. And usually it's from different genres, from different eras. So in this case, it was like, okay, this is the assassin kind of genre. Wouldn't it be great if there's an assassin who stumbles into a kidnap thriller? So we have those two worlds, a little bit film noir, wandering, you know, into a little bit of assassin, wandering into a film noir kind of thing. For me, it always starts with this triangle, which is Hitchcock, Kurosawa, and Leone. All of them were doing this, you know, with Hitchcock, it's the contract killer, the hitman. With Kurosawa, it's the samurai turning Ronin. And, you know, with Sergio Leone, it's all the gunslingers. And here it kind of, all right, this is an assassin going into a Kurosawa kidnap thriller, I don't know, for example. And now, like, oh, okay, this is new. Now we have that moment where Sam character needs to come to a decision. Either she sticks to the old rules, to the codes, or she saves the kid. She tries to do both. And that's where something new is born. So I'll get more comfortable as we. I feel.
That was a good answer.
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah. Well, Karen, when you first read the script, I'm curious, how clear was it what kind of movie this was going to be? And, you know, what was your initial response, and what made you want to take that apart?
I don't know if it was that clear how it was going to turn out exactly. But I remember during the clinic, you know, the armless fight sequence, there was like a line of dialogue, or a line of stage direction, I think this is right, where you had written, the audience won't know whether to laugh at this or what to do, but they will know they've never seen anything like this before. And I think that was actually when I put the script down and rang my agents and was like, I have to be in this film because that is ballsy. It's going to be original.
Well, and what kinds of conversations did the two of you have initially about what kind of the movie was going to be, what the tone was going to be? Because, you know, I feel like it's a really challenging part for an actor, and also a fun part in a way, because you both, you know, it's got this kind of emotional weight to the mother-daughter stuff, and then you being the surrogate mother to the other daughter, but then it's also, you know, it's almost like a Buster Keaton comedy in places, and, you know, it's like, it's so So what kind of conversations did the two of you have initially when you were talking about this?
What did we talk about? I feel like I was just harping on about the psychology of it all, because I was like, I've read essays about abandonment issues. You were like, okay.
Well, it is a genre blender. It's a milkshake. From so many different things that you need kind of glue, and the glue is the characters, and the glue is, although it's like this heightened reality where you have this diner from the 50s and you have this library and they're all dressed and you don't really know what era it is happening or what year is it happening or where, but the glue is the characters, because they're always down to earth. Their relationship, their emotions, it's all about them. So I think we always knew that's going to be the glue. We can go really crazy, we can go Jackie Chan on the bowling alley scene, or we can go Looney Tunes, Buster Keaton on the, or Who Framed Roger Rabbit on the clinic fight scene, and we can go Sam Peckinpah, you know, going down in Blaze of Glory on the library scene. But as long as the characters doesn't know that we are doing, they're sticking to their world, to their relationship. So, you know, that's going to carry the movie. So that, I think, was the anchor. And we just spoke a lot about it. We read a little bit with Lena, with Chloe, and, you know, we just found the tone. But,
For me, I don't think I was, like, maybe aware of the tone so much as just trying to play it as truthfully as possible, even in the ridiculous, absurd moments. Like, I mean, that's probably, like, maybe, like, you know, if you really had to do that, that's probably the truth of it. And it looks absurd and insane.
Yeah, well, it's funny because, you know, when you talk about reading about abandonment issues and everything, it sounds kind of funny, but you can actually see that. Like, I feel like the interesting thing about the action sequences in this movie is they're almost like the musical numbers in a Vincent Minnelli movie or something. Like, they actually do tell you something about the characters. And I feel like the way your character fights, it is sort of like you're acting something out in all of these.
Yeah, for me, I wanted all of her aggression towards her mother to come out in all of the fighting. So it's like she's like pretty contained, and it's all bubbling under the surface, and then as soon as she gets violent, it's like, oh, there's the anger.
Well, since you brought up the bowling alley scene, I mean, that's such an incredible fight scene, and one of the things I like about it is, and one of the things I like in general about the way you direct action is that a lot of times you don't have as many cuts as most people would. You shoot from a little bit farther back with wide angle lenses. You really let the action, you know, play out. And I'm curious, what kind of preparation goes into a scene like that, you know, for both of you? I mean, like how much preparation do you, because it requires a lot of the actor to be able to do all of that.
Oh yeah, that wide tracking shot was probably the thing we rehearsed the most, just because there was no cut points to hide behind. You know, if it was slow and lackluster, you're gonna see it, especially in a wide shot, you know, so it's so we had to just rehearse the hell out of that. That was quite nerve-wracking, but exhilarating.
But not as much for me as for Karen, but, well, the wonderful and great Michael Sarrazin, that is the DP of this movie, Midnight Express, Oliver and Parker's movie, Planet of the Apes, Alfonso Cuarón, Prince, Harry Potter, so we're talking about a guy, I think, is 80. We're talking about old school, and the only reason I'm allowing myself to talk about him like that because he's in better shape than me.
But the guy, to me.
The guy
is, he knows how to live.
Yeah.
That's another story.
Yeah, we can, later on we'll give you tips. But I think what kind of brought us together is after we read the script, I came to him like, this is going to be wide lenses. This is going to be all about the mise-en-scene. This is all going to be about textures. This is going to be not of these handheld kind of short lenses, you don't see the punches go in, you don't see the punches go out when it comes to the action, but also in the entire movie, I want to create this aesthetic that, you know, the movies I grew up on, the movies I love. I don't want it just to feel like contemporary for the sake of, you know, fake energy. So that's great. I think that created one very cinematic aspect of the movie, but it kind of keeps you exposed because you see everything, and you see the geography of everything. So you have to practice, and we had an amazing stunt coordinator, Laurent de Manuf, and his colleague Sebastian, and they knew we had nowhere to hide. but it was on them. It was on Karen and on Alina and on maybe not so much on Michelle Yao because she's Michelle Yao. So in those stories, like we're training for weeks, she comes for one day, and like in 5 minutes we're like, huh, that's not good. But they were terrific, and I remember Ron, I'm gonna do the accent because it's too good. Karen, she's got memory, ah, mwah. Let's bring more. And he would push the envelope, so we would add elements. Lina, she's vicious, let's give her more. So we kept pushing where we could. But it's, at the end of the day, it was all on them because they were so great at it. And then Michelle came in and showed us how it's done.
Well, the casting of Michelle reminds me of another question I had watching the movie, which is, how does the script, and just the movie in general, evolve and change once you're, as you're casting it? Because you have somebody like Michelle, who brings kind of her own associations, you know, the audience watching it, you know, associations they bring from other movies of hers, and then she's also just, all the actors have such strong presences in the movie. So how do the characters and script kind of change? I mean, I don't mean in terms of dialogue, but you know what I mean? Like, do the character, you know what I mean? Like, how do they inform the casting?
It changed a lot. You know, once we started a conversation with these amazing ladies, it started with Karen and Lena, who came first to the project, and we already started changing and shaping things, and they brought so much from themselves. With the librarians, it was even bigger changes, because never in my dreams I dreamt of having Angela Bassett, Michelle Yao, and Carla Gugino for these roles. I didn't know who were going to have, but I knew, you know, we're going to shape the roles according to the ladies. But once we had them, all right, we need to do some serious changing. We need to fit the character to the cast. And for example, with Michelle, we're not going to just give her guns. It's not very challenging for her. And they actually sent me to Paris to talk to her. So I needed to go and kind of tell her what we're going to do. So we were preparing this kind of action pitch. Beside of the character, which we spoke a lot about, but just in terms of the action, I can prepare like, okay, none of that is in the script right now, but you're going to have a chain. Okay. Appealing, and we have this trick which we call the Mary Poppins trick stunt. You're gonna get someone lassoed with a chain, and then you're gonna jump from a balcony. Okay, I think my fan base could relate to that. You know, we had to match the expectations of her and, you know, of us, because it's Michelle Yao.
Karen, maybe you talk a little bit more about the kind of work you did with the stunt coordinator on these scenes, because you have so many cool, like, you know, it's, I'm sure it was all very well planned, but it almost feels like improvisatory, so you're like picking up like gold bars and things, and, you know, using so many like unusual things as weapons. I mean, what was your collaboration with the stunt coordinator like?
It was great. What I loved so much was just all of the different types of weapons I got. I mean, I had a panda suitcase. Strapped to me, which was pretty creative. It just felt really, really inventive and like something I've never really seen before or gotten to do before. It was definitely a challenge though, especially the bowling alley sequence, because we had the three other actors in there and no stunt doubles, because it was just us all on camera. And it was like, it's nerve-wracking, because actors, when you hear action and you're doing an action sequence, you get it like 110% and you kind of lose control a little bit. And then what you're hoping is that the stunt doubles, who are very in control, who are acting with you, can kind of compensate. But when there's all actors, it's pretty scary right into your action. Like, oh god, what's gonna happen? But luckily nobody got hurt. Oh no, somebody did get hurt. I think someone was involved. That was bad.
You were
so he's okay. Oh no, it was me that did it.
Part of it was you, but actually when we shot the clinic scene, Ivan was in a wheelchair because I think it was probably Crowbar who really hit him in the knee.
Mm.
So for the next 2 days, I think he was a bit lazy. Like, he enjoyed kind of the pampering, but he was pushed around.
He was really making a meal of it, I will say.
Well, when you talk about not having anywhere to hide doing the action scenes this way. I mean, an extreme example of that is that long take toward the end of the movie in the diner that's all in slow motion. I mean, there you really have no room for error because you're both, you know, it's not only no cuts, but it's slow motion. Talk a little bit about shooting that, rehearsing that. I mean, how many tries did it take? How many days of rehearsal did you do? How many takes did you have to do?
We shot it, I think, towards the end, towards just before everyone left. It was a very strange in a way that it was, because we were working the schedule of everyone, so basically we had everyone coming the first day, and somewhere along the middle of the shoot, we were left just with Karen and Lena. So I think we shot it towards the departure of all the librarians. And the whole idea came because I knew that after the library sequence, I don't want to, you know, dial it to 11.
Yeah.
The library sequence was already big, and this was more of an emotional scene. So it wasn't really in the script like that, but it kind of came to be like the idea, and then they practiced so much. We got so many videos of them practicing with card boxes. And I think they practiced for a couple of weeks, but then it's Berlin in the summer, inside a stage with no AC. The location is tiny. Like 20 stunt people, 5 members of the cast, all the camera crews, and you need to shoot slow motion, 5 times slower. So basically, you need 5 times the lighting. It was hard. And every time we had to reset, it's 2 hours. So we had 5 takes. And everyone needs to hit their mark. There was one moment where we decided, oh, maybe we can cut. Like, no. One take. This is it. We're not gonna cut between takes. And I think we had it on the 4th take, except for one thing. If you see it again, there's a guy on the right side, and he just jump in the air, and he does this kind of scissor movement, which was beautiful, beautiful. And he did it the first take. He did it the second take. He did it the third take. And in the 4th take, it was just perfect on everyone else. Everyone hit the marks. He didn't do it. So he was like, okay, let's...
Why?
I don't know.
Why?
So we did the last and 5th take, and it was just perfect. And, one of the most challenging, but I think the most rewarding thing we did.
And so you said you shot in Berlin. You know, another thing I like about the movie is that whole, you know, aspect of it where it's very precise in its details, and yet also completely undefined in terms of when it takes place, where it takes place, where the city is. And I'm curious, how and why did you choose Berlin to shoot it?
Berlin is this mixture of old and new. I mean, so much is new there, but it's still monumental. And then you have all the influences from the Cold War. So you have this huge building that actually looked like a spaceship. You go inside, you open a room, you open a door, like just a side door, and it's a tennis court. It's huge, it's massive, it's called the ICC, it's unbelievable. So that's where we shot the video store, and that's the parking shootout with the monsters. But Berlin is just so unique and so weird and strange, and it just felt perfect for kind of the heightened reality, nowhere, out of place, out of time. And it basically will let you shoot anywhere, so that's also right. They're very, very friendly, the Germans.
Another thing I wanted to ask you about, you were talking about Michael Saracen, and again, one of the great cinematographers of all time. And, you know, maybe you think your previous movies, which I love, are much, much more modest in scale than this. And here, you're working on a much bigger canvas, and you're working with people like Michael Saracen, who, you know, did Fame, Angel Heart, and he's been around forever. And I'm curious how that changed, if it did, your approach to filmmaking, that you were suddenly, you know, working with people with that level of experience and with these kinds of resources. I mean, what was different about it? What were the pleasures of it? What were the challenges?
There were only pleasures. Working with Michael Saracen, with Louis Foglet, the costume designer who did all of George Clooney's movies, who did Ant-Man and the Wasp, and, you know, Tony Scott movies. She's also been around. She was the only one who can boss Michael. They knew each other. And David Chuneman, the production designer, who did who was an art director, I think, on Inglourious Basterds, and was doing Atomic Blonde and Hobson Shaw and now Bullet Train. So we had a nice mixture of old school and new school, but they were all top-notch professionals. So basically, I did a lot of listening.
Yeah.
And I think same goes for the cast. Between all of them, so much more experienced than I am. So it was a lot of listening.
I felt that way about the cast as well. I felt like I was just learning so much about how to act just by watching those women. And I was also starstruck for the entire film, which is horrible, actually. To just have, oh my God, I'm around these people all day. But no, it was really, really cool. Gosh, Angela Bassett, it just has the most gravitas of anyone ever. I just needed to say that.
And then you've also got, you know, you got that end of experience, and then you've got Chloe, the little girl, and
yeah.
There's this kind of, you know, there's this kind of running joke in the movie about you having everybody protecting Emily from the language and violence around her and stuff like that. And I'm kind of curious, what sorts of conversations the two of you had with her about the violence and all that kind of stuff in this movie? I mean, was it something similar, or was it sort of you just treat her like one of the other actors?
I'll tell a joke, and then you'll tell.
And then you'll leave me with a
No, we had, when I spoke to her the first couple of times, I was under the impression she did read the whole script. Because the script is violent and it's very graphic. And so I was always, you know, we auditioned her for the scene in the car, you know, you're bleeding. And then she starts talking about the other scene that she can't wait to see the cleaning fight and seeing all the slashing and wait a minute, did you read this? Oh yeah, I love these kind of things. But she was always with her mom, and we even had a child psychologist, with us. So we were explaining to her, but you can also see behind the scenes, like, you know, this is fake blood. But there was one, you know, incident. We were shooting in the basement. We were like, fucking Narnia, when they go in. And it was very slippery stairs into a very slippery basement, and you know, we were all going down, and Michael almost slips, and he goes, I'm sorry, there's no kids around, right? It's the Quentin cinema. Fucking idiots, I told you a million fucking times, put some fucking lightnings here. I could have drop dead, you motherfucking, for like 2 solid minutes. And then he goes, oh, hi, Chloe. And she goes, I am very sorry. And she goes like, yeah, I've heard worse. So it was hard, it was easy to sometimes forget that's a little kid, because she was such an adult, and she kind of pranked Karen all the time.
She was, yeah, she was having fun. I'm just now remembering, speaking of adults, that kids can only work in Germany 3 hours a day. Is that right? So I think about how much she was in the film. So I just like was doing the scene, and I like walked in, and then I looked up, and then what I saw was an adult dressed as her with a wig on, and I was like, ah! It was a fully grown adult. I couldn't believe it. I just wasn't. No one told me it was gonna happen. I would love to see that take, actually.
I remember once entering the elevator when we were doing the scene, like. So what's the plan? I called it Uber.
Oh, yeah.
So I was going for the standing, and I look around, and it's all your standings, and it's like this Spaceballs moment. You're not sure what's going on. It's reality just leaked a little bit.
But Karen, I was curious, like, how you worked with Chloe, because the two of you had such queer chemistry on screen together.
I think we were just silly the whole time. Like, we were just like making up a lot of songs, making Instagram videos that have not premiered yet, but they will. We just kind of had a laugh. Like, I wasn't consciously doing that, but like, I think it was good to just keep it light amongst all of the violence, you know. So I was like killing people, but then it was like fun.
Well, that leads to another question, which is, you know, this is a movie where it does feel like, to the audience, like everyone on the screen is sort of having a great time. Like, there's this infectious energy that comes out. And I guess I'm curious, you know, what kind of environment do you like to try to create on the set, you know, with everybody? I mean, are you the kind of director? Do you like everybody to be having fun? Do you like guys crack a whip sometimes? I mean,
there was no whips on this set. I mean, they owned it. Sometimes I was like, feel like I'm a guest. They had so much fun. It's like, we are ready to shoot. What are they doing? They're having fun. They're doing one of their Instagram, or you can hear Karen singing. It was so much, I mean, the energy was so great and so positive, and the chemistry between all of them was great. It was really just a couple of fun months. I'm not the kind of director who goes around with a whip.
Well, and Karen, I was a big fan of the movie you directed, Party's Just Beginning.
Oh,
and
you.
I was wondering if. And I was curious if, you know, directing your own film, and I think you've done some shorts and things too, has that changed your approach at all to acting, or the way you look at it, or the way you work on a set, or anything?
I think it may be easier to work with now, just because I feel like I understand just how vital and important it is to support the director and their vision, and then you're going to have the chances of something really, truly individual and unique and interesting, rather than a watered-down, diluted movie, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, I'm so behind the overall vision, and I just want to support and to help and lend to that in any way that I can. But also, you know, within my kind of little area, being like, I think it should be like this, and then I'm always like, can I have a fun run where the directors aren't allowed to give me, there's another director in the house, Riley Stearns is here, and he knows what I'm talking about. Basically, right, so like, I'll do what the directors want, and then I'll be like, can I have a fun run, and then, and they're not allowed to give me any notes whatsoever, and they always try to, but I say no, and I get to do whatever I want, and to go wherever I want, and say whatever I want. So this is my new thing that I like to do.
We're running low on time, but one thing I had to ask you about is, you know, I think any great action hero needs an iconic costume, and like the bowling jacket is sort of a great iconic costume, and I'm curious where you guys came up with that, and was it something that evolved, or was it just, you know, the costumes that I bring in and that was the one, or?
That was all you.
Well, it was Louise Froglay. She's amazing. I had a couple of ideas, but she's just a magician. I mean, I knew that I didn't want something. It's the part of the movie where Sam's character is starting her transformation, becoming a butterfly, losing the outfit of the fur and putting it behind it. So we knew we wanted something colorful, but also functional. The entire movie was about the ladies feeling comfortable, not walking on heels or with leather or with nothing like that. You know, they're professionals, so it had to, you know, serve both, be functional and be cool, and that just came to be. It's kind of a moment of inspiration.
And you know, you mentioned that this was, that was tonight the first night that you've seen the movie. This was the first time you've seen the movie on the big screen with an audience.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the finished one.
Yeah. So when you're, you know, with a movie like this, where I feel like the tone is so delicate. I mean, it is, you know, all of your movies, you have this kind of line between violence and humor, and it's kind of like you could, if you slip the wrong way, it won't work exactly the right way. And I'm curious, when you're editing something like this, how do you stay objective about whether or not that tone is working? I mean, do you show the movie to friends, or do you do any kind of test screening, or is it just all your own intuition?
No, we did some test screening. You know, friends, everyone is, everyone's a target. Sometimes it's just a scene, sometimes it's a sequence, sometimes, because music is so important. For example, the clinic fight. We had so many Stilevo Capitani kind of
composer. I was listening to that every single morning on the way to work, all of his stuff.
So we did so many tests until you, and I think it was after one of the, for example, that clinic fight, we had a test screening in London, and I felt the audience wasn't as crazy as I hoped it would be on the clinic fight. So I rang Frankie and I told him, remember that little piece of mariachi music that you had for the Monsters Shootout that we decided not to use? Can you pump it up and see what that does? And all of a sudden, that's the magic. That's kind of the lyrics. But it's a lot of, you know, mix and match and attempts. And music got so much to do with it, with the tone and with the way it's placed.
Yeah, and the use of music in the movie is fantastic. And, you know, I think it played great here tonight. And I really appreciate you both coming out here and watching the movie with us on the big screen and talking with me about it.